Interesting.
Yeah.
Well, let's keep going in terms of the phenomenology, but this is by way of review. We want to get to treatment as well. And just remind ourselves that, again, you have some overlap in symptoms, and understanding the level and degree of hypomania to frank mania is on a dimensional scale. And, you know, just remind ourselves that we have to ask, have you ever been cheerful, high, terrific, not your normal self, couldn't imagine life being better, or explosively irritable, that index manic episode. It takes less than 5 seconds to ask that question.
Yep.
And then when you realize that that's not actually the threshold you're meeting, then you can go on to some of the gray zone stuff, the hypomanias, the time criteria, if you will, that help you understand the dimensionality of the cyclicity and the rhythms of the mood disorder. And I would say, you know, I use mood charts. How about you in clinical practice to enhance and augment? It's not always the best tool because patients don't use it reliably. There's some great apps that are available too. But I'd be curious, you know, how else can we help our audience think about ways to really capture cyclicity?
You know, I think that the mood chart is still tried, tested, and true. I still use pencil and paper, although I'm not completely in the Stone Age. We do have technology, and we can have patients chart that. Eventually, it's going to be great to have what's called momentary assessment, where they can just enter it into an app and capture it in real time. But this is critical, because bipolar 2 disorder especially is so often missed. And a lot of these episodes are changing, they're brief. By definition, hypomania is only 4 days. But very often, although four days is required for the diagnosis, many people will have hypomanic experiences that last a day or two. These are often in the context of personality, if not temperamental dysregulation of mood. These folks often have a trauma history because the chaos of the mood, the chaos of the cognition, the chaos of the behavior exists in a natural habitat of chaos. So you got to try and suss all this out. But I think BP2 is very often, by the way, I often say BP2 is often been described as decaffeinated BP1. It is not decaffeinated BP1. BP2 is as common, it is as severe, it is as, if not more, chronic and debilitating than BP1 when you look at the number of depressions, the duration of the depressions. When you look at the suicidality literature, it is as concerning, if not worse, in BP2 than BP1.
So now, don't let that, don't, you know, does not lead to hospitalization fool you is the major point here.